Good evening. Today we are going to talk about vector algebra from where we left in the last class. And in the last class, what we have seen is actually the scalar products of two vectors and vector product of two vectors, besides the fundamentals of how a vector is represented and so on and so forth, and definition of unit vectors. In this class, what we are going to see is, suppose I have three vectors, and how do they operate in when it is in product form? That is the thing. Okay, so similar to the dot product, we are going to have both the scalar triple product and vector triple product. So that we are going to deal. And then one another thing that I want to state is basically, in the last class, we mainly focused on the what we know about the rectangular coordinate system. So we focused only on the Cartesian coordinate system because we are familiar with that. And within the Cartesian coordinate system, I said the unit vectors along x, y, and z directions are ax hat, ay hat, and ac hat. This is one way of representation. The second way of representation that people are familiar, or also you see it in textbook, is ijk along the x, y, z direction respectively. Okay, so this I just wanted to add up in case if it comes numerical problem, ax hat or ay hat or az hat, that is one way of representing a vector in the x, y, z direction. The other one is ijk. Okay, so I'm sure that you know it already, but just for the sake of completeness, I'm stating that fact again. So let us first deal with the scalar and vector triple product, following which we'll go to scalar and vector components, how to represent. Okay, how to represent a vector or as a projection on another vector. Okay, and if it is in scalar component, we have to project it in scalar manner, and which means it should have only value. If it is projected in a vector form, then you have a vector component. How do we do that? That is the second thing that we'll talk about. The third one, we'll do some numerical problems to reinforce our learning process. So what is a scalar triple product? Let us say I have a vector A, and there are two other vectors B and C, and if I have to do the scalar triple product, as the name sounds, triple product means you are involving three vectors, namely here A, B, C, and the resultant operation out of this triple product must get a scalar value. So therefore, definitely you need to have this scalar product, means it should reflect that. So therefore, first so how do they operate? There is nothing like A dot B dot C. That is foolish. Okay, so that doesn't sound nice, and it is incorrect also. Okay, so there is only thing that is there is basically we have vector A dot B cross C, which means the first operation here is the cross product between B and C you take within the bracket, and then you take the resultant vector dotted with vector A, resulting in a scalar component. Now, what is the significance of such a scalar triple product? It represents the volume of a parallelepiped, as seen from this image, courtesy due to the Jitse Neeson. Okay, it is available in Wikimedia. Therefore, I have given the courtesy over there for taking that image. Vector, how do we calculate? The next question comes in play. So the next question comes in play. We have how do we calculate? We know what is B cross C in matrix form or determinant form. Therefore, now A dot B cross C comes, you should get a scalar value. So it involves, you can prove that in determinant form, it comes like this. AX, AY, AZ, the first row, BX, BY, BC in the second row, and CX, CC, CYCC. Now, how do we calculate this? if I am looking at the first one, I will take the first component AX, and then you do, you leave that column and the first top row, remaining four elements are there, BY, BC, CY, CC. So you have to do the cross. Okay, so that is how it is done. And I am sure that you are familiar, and last class itself explained how this is done. So, because this is in determinant form, we know from the well-known property of the determinant, if we interchange rows once, we get a minus sign. If we interchange twice, you will get minus of minus, then it becomes plus. So this is like, it just follows the cyclic manner, ABC. So A dot BC, it's called a box product also. A dot B cross C is nothing but BCA equal to CAB. Okay, so the way it is written is ABC equal to BCA equal to CAB, which is nothing but vector A dotted with vector, the resultant of the B cross C equal to vector B dotted with resultant of vector C and A cross operation, and then equal to vector C dotted with the resultant vector coming from the operation of A cross B. That is the scalar product. Now we come to vector triple product. Vector triple product is basically, you again have three vectors involved, A, B, C. And these vectors, when they operate in, definitely because B cross C is already vector, we have seen that. There is a direction associated with the resultant vector. That resultant vector, it undergoes again another cross product operation with vector A. You should get a another vector. So you can prove this, although the scope of this, this course is not mathematics. Rather, we want to use mathematics to understand electromagnetics. Therefore, I am straight away giving this rule. What is well known as, well known to us as back minus cab rule. Okay. And to remember this, normally when you hire a cab, you sit in the back. So you can remember this way. It is called back minus cab rule. Okay. So it should result in this operation. Now, be careful here. A cross, the resultant of B cross C is not same as the resultant of A cross B cross C. Okay. Because the vectors, it will give a different direction, and then you will not get the same vector. You can prove that again. Therefore, the thing is like vector A dotted with vector B multiplied by vector C is not same as, is not equal to vector A within bracket vector B dotted with vector C, like what is written here. They are not equal. And I am sure that you can understand it, and it is obvious. Now, what is equal is basically, if I have two vectors dot product, it should lead to a scalar value. Therefore, if I write it because of the commutative rule and also the product rule, okay, you have this vector A dot B is basically like a scalar number. You multiply with the vector R, you take the vector first and multiply with the scalar, both are equal. So the second statement holds good, while the first statement is not holding good because of this cross product relationship. I'm sure you are clear. There is no special significance associated for vector triple product. It is simply why we are learning this, because we are learning these triple products because we are going to make use of this formulae while doing higher order mathematics involving electromagnetic fields. Now, what is a scalar and vector component? Again, a scalar component means a component which has no direction. The resultant, whatever you are getting it, should be representing only a value. What is that? And vector component means the resultant should have a vector direction. So this is going to be used extensively during the next 2-3 classes, where we talk about the different orthogonal coordinate systems, namely the cylindrical and spherical polar coordinate system, where we will be using this concept of projecting one vector over the other. When we project one vector over the other, you can actually get the scalar component or vector component, as will be demonstrated here. So let us say we have vector A. Now I bring the vector b, and they make an angle theta between them. Okay. Now I want to know projection of vector a on b, which means let me redo it again. I have the projection like this. Basically, I am sweeping this vector a onto b through this angle theta. I will get this projection. Okay. If I get this projection, okay, then how do I mathematically represent it? This is represented easily. It is not very difficult. It is represent. You get the answer as a cos theta. How? Because vector a can be written in terms of, there are two ways of looking at it. Either you use the formula, or you use the resolution of vectors. Okay. If I resolve the vector a, I can resolve it into horizontal and vertical component. Here I am talking about the horizontal component. That is one way of talking about it. The other way, that is the easiest way. The other way is you can take from the fundamental concept of the scalar product of the two vectors, namely vector a dot vector b, you get mod a mod b cosine of the angle between them, which is nothing but ab cos theta. Now what I do is, how to get this a cos theta? A cos theta is gotten as vector a dot vector b by mod b. What I have done is, I have taken this b, I have written it as mod b. That's all. Now vector b divided by mod b is nothing but the unit vector along vector b direction. So what is the unit vector? B hat. So you get actually a cos theta is nothing but a vector a dotted with unit vector b. Okay. So you can easily expand it. You see that it's very obvious, nothing difficult there. Now what about the vector component? Vector component should include the vector direction along b. Suppose if I want vector component of b on a, then it must be written as b cos theta vector a hat. Hat means it is unit vector. Otherwise I will say simply vector. Whenever I use the word cap or hat, that means I am talking about the unit vector along the respective vector, respective symbol. Okay. So this is very simple, straightforward. So you get, now if I want to know the vertical component, like what is shown here, if I want to know this vertical component, we can actually use the triangular law of addition of vectors. So I can get the vertical component using this thing, or what is known as the head to tail rule, and then I can get this as it is. Okay. So this concept of scalar and vector component, it looks very easy, but sometime when you get into curved surfaces, you got to think a lot. We will encounter such examples when we learn spherical coordinate system, which is little more difficult than the cylindrical coordinate system. In Cartesian coordinate system, which we are well familiar with, all the three axes are linear. But in cylindrical coordinate system, I will introduce one angular component while the other two are linear. But in spherical polar coordinate system, we need to invoke two angular coordinates. Then the difficulty comes. Now, if I have to invoke all the three as angular components, then it is a generalized curvilinear coordinate system. Okay. So we will talk about it in the next lectures. So don't worry about it right now. So this is how the vertical component is gotten, and this vertical component is nothing but vector AV is the V represents the vertical component equal to vector A minus vector AH. It's straight away following from your head to tail rule component and a triangular law of addition. Now let us take some examples of the problem for us to reinforce the concepts that we have learned through the last two lectures, today's lecture and yesterday's lecture. Now, the first problem is about an aeroplane flying at a speed of 350 km per hour in the western direction, in the along west, and there is a wind blowing northwest at 40 km per hour. What is the true airspeed and in what direction is the aeroplane heading? This is the question. So how do we do this? So in such a problem, just try to give a minute and think. First thing you must do is what is given and how do I go about it. So this is how you develop the art of problem solving. First, you have east, north, identify the directions east, west, south, north. So here is how I have identified. Having identified, I have been given the aeroplane is flying along the west direction. Okay, and this, the way I have drawn the diagram, you can clearly see the north is pointing the positive x direction, y direction, south is pointing the negative y direction, east is pointing the positive x direction, west is pointing the negative x direction. Okay, now the wind is flowing northwest, which means it must be flowing in this direction. Wait a second. In this direction, and the aeroplane is flying along the west direction. Now, because of the effect of wind, what will be the true airspeed and in what direction will the aeroplane head? This is the problem. Once we have understood the problem, then the solution becomes easy. Let us pictorially draw it. This is the direction of the aeroplane because it is along the west direction. And this represents the ground speed of the aeroplane. Having said that, now what is the direction of the wind? It is in the northeast direction, northwest direction, sorry, the northwest direction, and it makes an angle and it is identified here as the wind direction. Now, if I want to find the true airspeed, I need to, it will be along the resultant of these two vectors. So how do I get pictorially the resultant of these two vectors? That is the question. So what I do is, this vector, wind speed vector, I am actually extending it without changing the direction like this. Okay, so I have extended it and it is shown in the dotted line. Now the resultant can be computed by two means, which you already familiar in the last class. One is what is known as the head to tail rule. The other is what is known as the parallelogram rule. I am going to do the parallelogram completion like this and then take the diagonal, which will be my resultant. Okay, now, so I need to identify what is the magnitude of this resultant as well as what angle does this, what direction the aeroplane hits. Okay, so there are two ways of computing these directions. Either I can compute with respect to the vertical or I can compute with respect to the horizontal. I will rather compute this direction with respect to the horizontal, okay? So, but I leave it to you. But when you write the result, you must write appropriately the result. I will explain that later. So, let us talk about this a little more. So what is the, how do I go about calculating? This is pictorial representation, fine. How do I go about it? First thing, you need to identify that the wind is blowing in northwest. What it means is, I can resolve this wind along the northern direction, along the western direction. Okay, so I am going to resolve it. What is the answer I am going to get? I am going to get like this. It makes an angle 45 degree. Why 45 degree? Northwest is exactly, whenever such a problem is given, you are entitled or you are allowed to assume the angle for northwest with respect to west or north is going to be 45 degree. Okay, so that is what is shown here. Given that, once we resolve, we can write the vector v as minus 40 by root 2 ax hat plus 40 by root 2 ay hat. Okay, so where are the components? This is this component over here and this component over here. The vertical component, the horizontal component. Once I resolve, now the reason minus y, it is because along minus x direction, which is very clear, evident. Now, what is the ground speed? Again, minus 350 because along minus x axis direction. So it represents the minus ax hat. Now, you have been given, all I need to do is now, I need to find the resultant. How do I do the resultant? This will be, the resultant is this vector plus this vector, and take the whatever resultant vector you get, you take the mod, and this is how it is done. So this is how it is done. And once we do this, we get minus of it is like if I have a vector a as ax ax small ax ax hat plus ay ay hat. If I have like that, then the mod a is nothing but your your square root of ax square plus ay square. Given this, let us do this. So what is the direction? How do I do this direction? So what I, for that, what I do is I mark an angle, because I told you already that I am going to compute with respect to horizontal. There is no harm done if you calculate with respect to vertical, but provided you write appropriately the answer for the direction. You must either say, if I compute it with respect to the horizontal, then I should say north of west. If I compute it with respect to the vertical, then I should say west of north. So north is my, so depending on which angle. So here I have taken it with respect to this one. Obviously, if I compute it with respect to the vertical, then it becomes 90 minus, and I mark that angle as, let us say, alpha. So when I mark it, what is the answer I'm going to get? I'm going to get this vector, resultant vector, which is here, which is VT. I should have marked it as VT. That is marked here. So VT with respect to this aeroplane, which is my VG, ground speed. So it becomes vector VT dotted with vector VG divided by mod VT mod VG. I get the angle alpha. If I do it the other way, I can do it with a vector wind, but then vector wind will become it becomes like the vertical you must take. So I must write it as vector v subscript v to say that it is wind. And then I must, you must remember that is, it is nothing but actually 90 minus alpha. I am sure that, so you can try to do it, and it is given as a homework for you. I hope you understood this problem. Let us move on to the second problem. Here, given three vectors a, b, c along x, y, z direction respectively, as shown here, determine the values of alpha and beta such that the resultant vector, say p, which is given as alpha a plus beta b plus c, is parallel to the y axis. So I am going to get a resultant vector, and I want to put the value of alpha and beta in such a manner that I should get only parallel to y axis. If it is only parallel to y axis, it is very clear that the component along x direction should vanish, the component along z direction should vanish. There are two conditions, there are two unknowns. So you can easily find by simultaneous equations, and here is how it is done. It is you can do it self-read. So this is what I told. First I do the resultant vector, and then AX, AC component must vanish. Therefore, I must equate it to zero, and then I get two equations. I substitute one over the other, I get alpha and beta as minus 3/2 for alpha and 1/2 for beta. Okay, so if it is along parallel to z axis, for example, then the resultant vector should have only the z component. X and y component must vanish. If it is along x axis, parallel to x axis, then the resultant component will be only along x axis. Therefore, y component and z component should vanish, or which must be equated to zero, so as to get alpha and beta. Okay, fine. Now the third problem is another typical problem. I have two points forming a straight line. I want to find the time taken for a signal traveling at 300 meter per second to get from origin to the midpoint of PQ. So here I am talking about bringing the position vector concept. But first of all, I need to locate the midpoint previous to doing that. What is the midpoint? Okay, so there are three coordinates for each point, right? Along x, y, z. Okay, for simplicity, let us assume that I have a point 100 and another point 300 lying obviously in x axis. The midpoint for this is actually 3 plus 1 divided by 2. Okay, fine. So this is how it is done. Okay, so it must be, whenever you do a midpoint, you take the average. Okay, it is not 3 minus 1, rather you take it as an average. So 2 points are given, 2, 4 minus 1, 12, 16, 9. You take the average, okay, of these 2 points, sum along the respective direction and take the average. And you see here, for example, 12, 2 is given. So which means it is 14 divided by 2 is 7. 4 and 16 is given, 20 divided by 2 is 10. Minus 1, 9 is given, it must be 2, 2 divided by 8. So 8 divided by 2 is 4. So once I have that point, then I can easily get the position vector, and mod position vector you can take. That will be the length of that. So the time taken will be the distance traveled by the speed, okay, of the signal. So which is clearly evidently seen. I'm sure all of you have understood this concept. There are, you are welcome to do many such problems. There are a number of books in vector algebra. Okay, I hope the concepts are clear. In the next class, we will be moving into orthogonal coordinate system. Look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.